Let's give it up for J2O! Come on, man. And he was sitting up, I was the first person to lash out. and me couldn't expect to go to street rotation. I reacted in that way, but you talk crazy. It's my finances that I gave you. I didn't need to give it to you. I gave it to you, but I thought we were close. So that's what happened.
And that's the thing. Notice what he said, though, that the consequences was going to jail. And so even though we don't like to do that, we have to go through that process. We have to think about the consequences. Okay? So you have to go through your mind and say, hey, is this $25 worth me losing the opportunity for me to be my best me, to reach my full potential? Because that's what happens a lot of times. We see it. We've seen people die over less than $25 in jail. So was it worth that? And if it is worth it, then I think your expectations are way too low. Okay? Yeah. So $25 to me is not enough for me, you know, to get to the point to where, you know, I'm going to be aggressive. Because when you go the aggressive route, it's going to escalate. Yeah. We already know that's what's going to happen. It's going to escalate. And I like what he said. One of the things that we, especially if you're a Christian, one of the things that we are charged to do is to be change agents. And you're not going to change people by doing the same thing that they do. When I went to college and I was learning my behavior specialist stuff, you know what? It was easy for me. You know why? Because all they was doing was using Christian principles. They was using the same thing that Jesus said when he said, if somebody strikes you on one cheek, turn to him the other.
Yeah.
Okay? We don't like that, though, because it makes us look like a punk. We don't like it. So we change it up and we say, no, that's not what he means. What he meant is that we have to show people a better way.
Yeah.
City on the hill. Lights to the world. What is all that? It is modeling the behavior that you want them to display. So that's what I did in the classroom. I modeled the behavior that I wanted my students to give back to me.
Yeah.
Okay? That's what we do. That's what we're supposed to do anyway. Yeah. We're supposed to model that behavior. All right? Now, back to scenario. Oh, you got this?
I have a question. You might have did him and give him from his classroom, then they got to go back out in the reality.
Right.
And every other might be street.
Right.
And that's all they see. So how do they sit there and put what you're saying from the classroom into their first day, learn the life that they have? How do they, it's like between the two,
Right.
So if one might hit somebody that's provided a settlement and they're going along the city for the right reasons.
Right.
So how do you decide between what you tell them in the classroom saying, hey, you make sure.
Right. Now, the reality is that we're not going to be able to save everybody. But what I was able to do is at least get the majority of my classroom on board. Because this is another reality. When you're an educator, you basically spend more time with, you know, everybody else's kids than they do. You do. So that means that you have the ability to try to influence them. But you know what happens? We're not showing them a better way. Yeah. We end up responding to them with the same aggressive behavior that they come at us with. So we're not helping them. And let me tell you something. My strategies did not work overnight. They did. I mean, it took me 6 weeks to 2 months, especially the students that came to me that was new. You know, the seventh, eighth graders, they knew me. And they actually helped me because they was able to tell a new student, hey, man, you don't want to do that in here, man. You're not going to have the fun that you want to have. You know, because that's what I did. I made my classroom fun. And you had to earn the opportunity to do this. This is what we did in my classroom every Friday. If you earned it. If you didn't earn it, you were somewhere else writing. Okay? But that's what happened. The hope is that if we show them with those 8 hours that we have with them in the classroom, if we show them, you know, a model to them, you know, the way that we want them to behave, then it's a possibility that they would change. Now, I had good parents. I used to work with my parents. You know, at first they wasn't good, but see, the one thing that I did is I didn't call them. The first call to my parents was not the bad stuff. You know, it was like, I'm glad that Jenny is in my classroom. It was exciting stuff. And so I set that precedent right there. And so now, when that parent gets that phone call from me, they're not so ready to not accept it. Okay? So that's what it is. It's we have to model. Because that was a big idea in school. It's model the behavior that you want them to accept. Okay? All right. Now, second scenario. And this happens to all of us. You're in Walmart, right? And you have an item. You're way over in the electronics, right? You have an item, and the item that's the sticker that's above it, same product, it says $15. But the sticker on the product says $25, right? And if you're like me, you know, I don't have time. Because you're not going to get anybody to come to you quick. You know, you say, man, is somebody in the electronics department? And most of the time they call somebody, hey, man, Johnny in the meat department, hey, come over here. So I don't have time to be waiting on Johnny in the meat department to come help me with electronics. You know, and that's basically about it. So you go up to the register and you say, hey, look, the price on the sticker above it says $15. This price says $25. And she gets smart. You're not having a good day. She say, that's the price that's on it. You can't see that? How do you respond?
Say that more than
hey, that's cool. Exactly what you say. I'm going to give it to you for $15. Okay? And that's because I responded you know, in a different way. Okay? Another thing that we have to be careful of is people controlling us. You know, and that's what my students, when I used to say that word, they say, man, ain't nobody controlling me, man. I beat that nigga head. You know, that's what they think control is. They think control is might and power. But I'm going to tell you right now, Jeff Lebo, he is controlling a lot of things. He's caused a lot of companies to falter. That's why we don't see Sears and stores like that, because his Amazon company is basically controlling and dictating, you know, what everybody else is doing. They really are. You know, so it's not in how big you are. It's not in how strong you are. Okay? That's not control. But when somebody can do something and they say this is what they're going to do and you do exactly that, guess what? They control you. Okay? And I'm going to give you, I'm going to talk about some real true stories in the classroom where I learned that those things really work. All right? Give it up for JTO. So, really,
you got to turn up.
Yeah, just like I was just explaining, I had a situation in the classroom one time. I had a student that went to the restroom. There were two other students sitting, you know, just sitting there, they were talking. And I don't know why my students think that they're whispering, but I hear everything they say. You know? And I'm paying attention because, you know, I think, for real, I'm a scientist. At every step, we were scientists and we're testing theories, right? And so they're talking. And this guy that's going to the restroom, he has earned that privilege. Because when they come to me, they don't have any privileges at all. They go to the restroom, they have to have one of my parents or me to go with them. This guy has earned the right to go to the restroom by himself, right? And so he's in the restroom, the other two students are talking, and one of them says, hey man, I'm going to say this right here. I forgot what he said he was going to say, but he said, I'm going to say this one word, and watch him, man. He's going to pick up a chair and throw it, and this word is going to have a body slam on the ground. Now, I don't body slam my students on the ground. I don't. It may look like that when you see it on video, but I don't body slam my students. You know, we learn the proper technique, right, for us. Don't we learn mindset? Don't we learn how to grab their hands in the front, and they go down on themselves, right? Looks like a body slam. But that's what they do. They say, Mr. Worm, you're a body slam, right? And I say, normally, I wouldn't let that play out. But again, I'm being a scientist. I want to see if that's true. Because if that's true, then it gives me a teaching point. You know, I can teach him. That's what I mean when I say they control you, right? And so the kid comes back in the classroom. He says that one thing. And guess what? Picks up a chair, throws it, and then he's coming at him. And true enough, I had to restrain him, and we go to the ground. Okay? But it gives me the opportunity to explain to him, look, man, he already said that that's what he was going to make you do. And I'm telling you right now, if you're explosive, your friends know what your triggers are.
Right.
Your family members know what your triggers are. And whenever you cross them the wrong way, they're going to pull that trigger. That's the dangerous part about people being able to control you. And so that's why we have to work on responding to people in non-violent ways. You know, I know a lot of times we don't learn those conflict resolution skills like that, but it's critical. It's critical. How many times have we heard in the last 6 months a young man, you know, get mad with his girlfriend or wife and end up killing the girlfriend and wife, children, and other family members? Too many times. And it's because we have too much explosion in our response to people being negative. And a lot of times they do it just because they know that we're going to respond in a negative way. Alright? And then that's the other thing is sometimes it's going to look like you are the one that started. Because when you go back to that student now, The guy that said the thing that set him off, guess what? His punishment was not going to be as bad as the guy that threw the chair at him and wanted to fight him. He's getting ready to go home for a couple of days. The other guy, probably going to get some negative points. You know, he's probably going to get some kind of discipline, but it's not going to be suspension. Because guess what? He just said something. He just said something. The other guy reacted to what he said. Okay. And the last thing, I want to tell you this story too again about sometimes students know if you're an educator, even if you're a parent, your children know what your trigger points are. They do. They do. And that goes back to what I was saying. You know, you have to model the behavior that you want your kid to show you back. Okay, so if you don't want them to cuss, guess what? If you can't get mad at them, you do that every other word. Right. If you're explosive, but you don't want your kids to be explosive, you're asking them to do something that they can't do because that's what they see on. All right. This is the last one, and I promise you we're going to end it right here. And I'm going to have my grandkids, if they're still up. I see one still up. Yeah, the turn off baby, is up. The turn off baby is up. But this is a true story. I had a student that he did something wrong, right? And I had to go, you know, look at the video, and I saw that it was him. So I'm suspending him for 2 days, right? Because that's how I did. They let me have my classroom. My principal didn't deal with my students. But I'm getting ready to suspend him for 2 days, right? And he said, "Coach, I didn't do anything." And I say, "Yeah, okay, then get the video up for me. Let me go bring the student in here and let's watch the video," right? And so we're watching the video, and I say, "See, that's you right there. It's coming out." You know, I know you've worn that outfit a couple of times, right? Now, in reality, you wear that outfit every day. But I'm nice. You know, I'm the kind of person that, you know, I'm not going to come up in the room, you know, like my wife, she's coming in the room. Somebody stink! You know, I'm gonna be nice and polite. I'm gonna say, "Oh, the here, not that present." You know, so I'm a little bit different. So I'm a little bit different than my wife is. But you know, I told him, I said, "Yeah, I struggled with that outfit a couple of times, man." He said, "That's not me, man." And so I blew it up just a little bit so that he can see his face really good. And he's like, "Coach, that ain't me. That's me." And at that point, I knew what he was trying to do. So I say, "Okay, this is what's going to happen. You're going to go home for 2 days. And if your mama has a problem with that, she can come up here. I'll show her how to go through the process and dispute it." But this is what he wanted me to do. A lot of times students do things like that because they know teachers are going to react and they're trying to get you to blow up. Okay, so he wanted me to end up on Channel 5 News, you know, where they're breaking news, teacher in here, body slam student, and he had a two-stroke reel. To be the more, give us the story. "Oh, yeah, we have a teacher, Coach Eric Werner, he's suspended without pay." That's what they want us to do, and that's what a lot of teachers need. And so I knew it. And so I say, "Look, you're going home for 2 days, right?" And for most students, when you get suspended, your parents have to come get you right then, right? For my students, they have to stay all day because for a couple of reasons. And all of them have to do with, I know their parents are not going to come get them. I know they're not. You know, they're either not going to answer the phone. Because if my parents saw that 770-957, they're not going to answer the phone. Because that's Henry County. That's Henry County School's number. So if they see that number, I don't care if it's a blessing behind that call, they're going to miss that blessing because they're not answering their call. And you know what? I understand them because, you know, my kids were 11, 12, 13. So my parents have been traumatized by that number for years because every time that number calls and they answer, they end up spending extra time at home with their kids. You know? And so they end up not answering that call. Now, that was a couple of years ago. I think the parents are more appreciative of teachers now. After the pandemic, you know, they love teachers. I think I saw a survey where it said before the pandemic, 55% of parents say that they love their child's teacher. Recently, 99.9% say we love our teacher. And don't expect me this year, I promise you, the next teacher's appreciation, somebody's going to get some blame. Somebody's going to get a car, somebody's going to get something. The parents are more appreciative. And I'm my daughter, I saw her one day because my daughter, one of my grandsons got suspended for a day, right? And so he ended up going to do a, I went to do a, in our own, I mean, a CIT, youth training, intervention training, right? And it was with police officers. So they thought it was there, and you know, he didn't in trouble, you know. So they were, like talking to him. But, this is the thing. She was talking to my wife, and normally they get into that conversation about what did the teacher do.
Right.
You know, but my daughter this time, she didn't say, well, the teacher didn't do nothing. I know everything she said, I see Tyson on doing. And I'm like, this was, and then I thought, growth and mature. Then I say, no, it's the pandemic. It's the pandemic. It's the pandemic. But whatever, it's great. But anyway, you know, I know my parents are not going to answer their phone call. They're not going to come get their kid. So the kids have to stay there with me all day until the end of the day. And I don't have a problem with it because normally they're not going to do anything. You know, they're already in trouble. You know, most of my kids are not going to do anything more than that. But at the end of the day, I'm getting ready to dismiss these kids to the bus.
Hey, that dude.
And, this kid comes up to me and he says, "Coach Worthy, it was me. I didn't want to go home and be mad." And I got emotional because, look, parents, listen. Whenever my students make a move in the direction that I want them to be, because it seems like he's making a move to accepting responsibility, I make a big deal out of it. So I'm like, golly, man, that's big time right there. That's big boy stuff. That's man stuff. Give me some. See you in three school days. Because he had to accept the responsibility for what he did. Okay? But I said all that to say is that we can't allow people to control our narrative and to determine if we're going to reach our full potential in life, all right? And also, because most of us Christians, we're charged to be change agents. So change agents don't do the same thing that other people do. We do something different because we want to show them a better way, all right? I'm Eric Worthy. Remember, be all you can be by doing
I'm going to go to the next one.
Lord Father.